No holds barred match. Bret the Hitman Hart versus Mr. McMahon. The match that was 10 years too late. Let's be perfectly honest here. This matchup should have happened a long time ago. Two major problems I have with this match. One was controllable, one was not. The non-controllable factor was Bret the Hitman Hart and his physical health and the insurance company. The fact was, while Bret, I'm sure, was more than willing to take bumps, they could not let him take bumps. Lloyd's of London, who owns Bret Hart's life insurance policy, absolutely refused to let him, including threatening to shut off his insurance if he even dared actually take any bumps during that matchup after having the stroke. So that really left this match being very one-dimensional, with pretty much the entire match of Bret Hart beating the holy fuck out of Vince McMahon. Now, that part of it felt good as a longtime Bret Hart fan, but this was not up to Bret Hart's standards. I have seen some really good Bret Hart matches. I've seen some bad Bret Hart matches. And this was definitely not his best match. It wasn't even close to being even his, near his bottom of the barrel. This was probably among his worst ones, probably. Because, let's be honest, I've seen Bret Hart versus the Berserker, and that match was more technically sound than this one was. The one that was within their control was the way they handled the Hart family betrayal and the Hart family turning on Vince. What I would have liked to have seen was Vince McMahon think he had succeeded in buying off the Hart family. I would have then liked to have seen a point where Bret, is like, to hell with it. My family's betrayed me, but I'm still going to go after you. Pounding on Vince, knocks Vince out of the ring. The first time Vince goes out, the lumberjacks, the Hart family are helping him up, and then suddenly they attack him, and that's when Bret gets on the mic and says, guess what, Brent? This time, Bret screwed Vince. But the long preamble at the beginning, just, if there was any chance, there was like this much chance that we believed it. And I thought that, and when I was watching it originally, it was like, okay, this is kind of cool. I want to see where they go with it. And then, boom, they turn right around and ruin it. And it just literally was like, oh, look at this nice juicy steak. Guess what? It's rubber. So, that just, it didn't happen. It didn't go over well. And honestly, it was just plain dumb the way they handled it. And it was handled very, very poorly. The other issue was that this match just ran way too long. There was a point where the audience got bored. And there's only so many times you can watch Vince get pounded with a crowbar before it just sort of seems redundant and pointless and cartoonish in a way. And Vince McMahon looked like a big fucking pussy in comparison to the rather brutal beating and matchup that he took against Shawn Michaels just a couple years earlier. So you gotta figure, this was not exactly top of the tier. In the end, the satisfactory ending helped it, but I still could only give this match a D+, because as far as the match went, it was caca. And as far as the finish went, it was good for the Hart, and it was good to see Bret Hart get his revenge, but this match was shit. And Bret has had so much better in his career, and the fact that this was his second-to-last match, his last one being the one where he inexplicably took the U.S. belt off of The Miz in about 45 seconds, it's not a solid way to end the legacy of the best there is, best there was, and best there ever will be. In the World Heavyweight Championship match, the Royal Rumble winner Edge challenged Chris Jericho. This match was what you expected it to be. These men put on a solid show. This was probably one of the better matches of this WrestleMania. It had the right build, the right pace, the right background story, and they handled the in-ring very well. But what more would you expect from two solid Canadian superstars like Chris Jericho and Edge? And one man who is already a Hall of Famer and another man who is destined to be a Hall of Famer. It is fact that these two put on an excellent program. While I wouldn't say that it was, blowing everything else out of the water, it certainly blew most of the rest of the card out of the water. And when it came down to the world title matches, I think it was really, really good. I gave it a B. Like I mentioned earlier, I'm definitely surprised Jack Swagger did not cash in on Jericho after the match was over, and the fact that they waited all the way, waited 2 days till the SmackDown taping to do it, just goes to show you how little they thought of Jack Swagger being the Money in the Bank holder. Honestly, I would have liked to have seen somebody else get it instead of Swagger, because maybe they would have done a better push with him. But Swagger's world title reign and how pathetic it was not something to talk about here, per se. We then went on to the 10-Diva tag team match, and I use the term tag team match very liberally on this one, as you had the team of Layla, Vicky Guerrero, Michelle McCool, Maryse, and Alicia Fox teaming up to take on Eve Torres, Mickie James, Kelly Kelly, Gail Kim, and Beth Phoenix. And this matchup was not what I would refer to as a match. There were maybe two tags out of the entire matchup. Of course, at one point, Vicky Guerrero gets in, and it pretty much became a free-for-all of, hey, everybody who has a finishing maneuver, hit it! And that's pretty much what happened, is everybody got to hit their finishing maneuver on somebody else, nobody really tagged in, the referee just went, fuck it, and let the thing keep going. Vicky Guerrero, in the end, wound up, climbing, or being helped to climb to the top rope, and did her little point upwards, which the fans thought, you know, to do her rather pathetic land on her feet and drop to the floor splash, or they call it bullfrog splash. And I just started to picture what it might be like. You know, she's pointing up to Eddie, and Eddie is looking down on his beloved wife, and his only reaction is, "Oi, mamacita, how many times do I tell you we wrestle, you don't? What are you doing? Why do you think I never let you be on top when we were having sex, Holmes? Jeez!" I don't do Eddie Guerrero impersonations. I apologize horribly to any of my Hispanic viewers who may have been offended by my horrible, horrible white boy Mexican accent. The fact is, and then afterwards, because she did it wrong and she pulled Kelly Kelly so far up, Kelly Kelly's shoulder came off the mat, so she had to, like, pancake her! It was like watching a really horrible prelude to the most disturbing lesbian scene in history. And that ended this 10 Diva tag match. That was hardly a tag match at all. I gave it a D-. Definitely one of the worst matches in WrestleMania history. The WWE Championship, Batista versus John Cena. For all the hype, for all the build, for everything that they wanted to put into this, for the fact of the history and Batista breaking Cena's neck, this match was bland. Bland, 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 bland. And when it came right down to it, there could have been so much more that they could have done, and they didn't. But then again, we're talking about two of the top stars in the WWE, John Cena and Batista. Certainly they have variety and skill and can do all sorts of different things in the ring. Certainly you don't have a one-note top superstar, because God forbid top-note superstars have any variety and capability in their maneuvers whatsoever. It doesn't happen. If you've noticed, I've been kind of yelling on this one because there are a lot of stuff about this that just sort of bug me at this WrestleMania. But this match was bland. I gave it a C. It was about what you expect for Batista versus John Cena, and this was the prelude to eventually Batista sitting in a wheelchair and going, "I quit! Fuck you, motherfuckers!" Yeah. At least they ended WrestleMania on a high note, and sort of a low note emotionally, but a high note with a match-wise, and that was the rematch between The Undertaker and Shawn Michaels, the streak versus the career. And while this match was probably not as good as, and not as well touted as the WrestleMania 25 version, certainly these two put on a great show, and they started hard and fast and went right at it. I enjoyed this matchup. I think that, you know, there wasn't much more that they could have done outside of Shawn and Taker maybe taking a couple more high spots, but I think Undertaker was also feeling a bit more ginger that year. And I don't mean red-haired, because that's where he was. I mean that his body was kind of beaten and bruised, and that was kind of where he was at. And after all, he's also sleeping with Michelle McCool, who's clearly not a ginger.
No, he's the ginger, remember?
Yeah, he's the ginger. Anyway, Couple things I noticed about the matchup. Taker gets cut open and is bleeding from the forearm. Little Nate forgets to put on the gloves. Oh no, he's infected! There's blood! Guy dries kiss, there's blood! For some reason at one point in the matchup, which I don't understand, they just randomly had turned the camera towards the stage, like somebody was going to run out and interfere in this matchup. Didn't happen. Happened for no reason. Somebody hit the wrong button and boop, look, it's the stage! And I felt that while the ending was solid, it was a little hackney, especially considering that just 2 years earlier, they did a very similar finish to Ric Flair versus Shawn Michaels, with Ric Flair being on the receiving end of the final blow. And this is the same one in this case. Undertaker telling Shawn to stay down, and Shawn slapping, doing the cut across the throat, slapping Undertaker across the face. Undertaker's mega tombstone, the leaping tombstone, that in itself was impressive. But I felt that the final moments before that, definitely a little hackney. But I like the respect at the end, Undertaker helping him to his feet and telling Shawn Michaels that you're one tough son of a bitch. Very cool, and Shawn, thanking the audience and, tears in his eyes, and going up the ramp and saying how he's going to drive his kids nuts for the next few weeks. Final score on that match was an A-. Definitely a good matchup. Doesn't quite meet the previous year, but it's not far off the mark. Final score for WrestleMania 26, overall, despite me yelling at the screen quite a bit during this video, was a C+. It was slightly above average, but really, there was only a couple of shining points, but most of it was pretty much just above the bland level, did not exactly meet WrestleMania standards, and this event could have been better had we not had two definable D matches, including a match that was 13 years in the making and damn sure should have been so much better than it was. But, circumstances and time don't always help things, and that's what happens sometimes. Next time on Mania Week, we head out to Atlanta, Georgia for WrestleMania 27, where The Rock returns to WrestleMania to host. But he fucking knew. See you there. I'm Mr. Spiffy, and, this Mania... I don't have anything this week, sorry.